Dan is watching. Hi. Hope you enjoyed. So our speaker today is Yiannis from New Jersey. And he will speak to us on Beyond Endoscopy, Relative Trace Formula. That's the title of his paper.
I don't remember the title of the talk. Some non-standard comparison of trace formulas. So thanks again for giving for the second time the opportunity to a Greek to talk during Hanukkah. It was a very interesting idea. David, if you're listening, welcome back, and we're sure that before too long you will be physically back with us. I'm going to talk about a comparison of trace formulas. The work of Langlands and Arthur has made it clear that factoriality is not really a relation between automorphic representations in one group and automorphic representations in another group. You cannot have factoriality from representations to representations. Factoriality, it has become clear, is something about comparing trace formulas, and more precisely comparing stable trace formulas for different groups. Although this might seem unnatural to you, the real question is not about automorphic representations, but about something else that has to be expressed in terms of trace formulas. More precisely, stable trace formulas. Now, stability will not be an issue for what I'm discussing today, but just to give an impression, just for those who are a bit familiar with the usual trace formula, let me recall one point of view of viewing the theory of endoscopy. So it consists of two steps. Step one, which is called pre-stabilization. is to take the trace formula on a certain group G. This is certain invariant distribution on the adelic points of G, and write it as its stable part. Again, we will not need stability today, so if you don't know what it is, I'm not going to define it. Just to make a mention of endoscopy, you write it as its stable part plus the sum over elliptic endoscopic data of the corresponding summons. These are still invariant distributions on G itself. And the second step is to compare each of these summons to the stable trace formula for a different group, which is called the elliptic endoscopic group. It's this comparison that establishes factoriality. And factoriality, once you establish it, I will explain what compare means in a simpler example in a moment, but I would like to mention that once you do such a comparison, it comes with extra luggage. It gives you something more. So this, once you do such a comparison, this gives what is called character relations. That is, relations between stable characters of automorphic representations for the group GE, and not exactly stable characters, what is called weighted characters for automorphic representations of the original group G.
example, or some explain to us what endoscopic data means, what G epsilon might mean.
I wouldn't like to do that. But one example is, you know, take SL2 and take a non-split torus. This is an endoscopic datum for SL2. This corresponds to an endoscopic datum, and then part of the spectrum of SL2 will be accounted for by characters of this torus. And also you will, this matching here spectrally will be interpreted as a relation between characters. So certain linear combinations of characters for SL2 or inside the same L packet will correspond to characters for the torus, whatever this means. But I will show simpler examples of comparisons in the context of the relative trace formula, where these character relations will be translated to period relations, relations about periods of automorphic forms. So I don't want to get into stability because it's actually more complicated than the example I'm going to talk about today. Okay, so I'm giving it just to orient you with familiar words, or more or less. Sorry? That was not my intention, but... Today I would like to actually focus on a specific example of comparing relative trace formulas. So I'm not going to talk about relative trace formulas in full generality. I'm just going to give specific examples. However, if you were in my colloquium talk on Thursday, or even if you were not, I mentioned that one kind of problems that we're interested in is to consider certain spherical homogeneous spaces G mod H, and it is conjectured that, let me put it in quotation marks, it's conjectured that the spectrum of G mod H is described by some dual group, as in the group case, some dual group GX check. Now, one can ask, what does it mean, the spectrum of G mod H? And the point I want to make today is that, if you were in the colloquium, you heard something about L2 of G mod H, or you heard something about C infinity of G mod H. But the point I want to make today is that the fine details of these conjectures, in every case that we know them, suggest that the real question is not about G mod H. It's not about the spectrum of a single homogeneous space, but the correct question is about the spectrum of the relative trace formula for G mod H mod H. And I will give specific examples of relative trace formulas today. But somehow, this double quotient here includes some inner forms. And those who are familiar with the Langlands conjectures know that, for instance, if you want to express local Langlands correctly, you need to put in some inner forms, Vaughan L packets. Similarly, for those who know about the Gross-Prasad periods, the local Gross-Prasad proven by Valtrousset includes some inner forms. This you cannot explain if you're just talking about G mod H. You need to talk about a double quotient like this. So somehow it is this space to which I will associate this dual group, and somehow there is a dream of a relative factoriality but factoriality in Langlands is about homomorphisms between, actually between L groups, but let me not go to that. It's about homomorphism between dual groups, but in this setting that I'm talking about, it's already very non-trivial to consider the case where dual groups match. So the little dream of relative factoriality is to compare the RTF for G1 mod H1 mod H1 and the RTF for G2 mod H2 mod H2 when the varieties G1 mod H1 and G2 mod H2 have the same L group, dual group. Well, these comparisons are done locally, but then if you want to decompose in representations, you have to use global arguments, and then these global arguments will give you back some local relations. So as a byproduct of such a comparison, this would give, it would give information about the local spectrum, but it would also give, among other things, period relations. So relations between H1 periods on G1 and H2 periods on G2. Let me recall what is the period. So suppose that I have pi, an automorphic representation, the space of an automorphic representation of a group G. Then the period over a subgroup H is the following functional. You take automorphic forms and you integrate them over the subgroup, adelic mod rational points of the subgroup H. So these periods are hiding inside of these relative trace formulas, and if you were able to compare two of them, then this would give you information about the periods. So let me give you an example of that, which is due to Zeke. I have to explain what I mean compare. There is a standard way of comparing, which you will see in example 1, and there is a new way of comparing, which you will see in example 2. Both of them give relations, okay? But I didn't even say what relations means, what kind of relations, right? So you will see. So the first example is due to Jacquet and is the method that Jacquet used in order to prove the theorem of Walsh-Fourier. So here G will be PGL2. I will let T be a non-trivial torus in G. Everything is over a global field K. T will be a non-trivial torus. Now, it's not the trivial subgroup. It's one-dimensional. Okay. Yes. So it's a torus, okay. It happens to be maximal. It also happens to be maximal. So, and to this torus is attached a quadratic Idel class character eta. This is trivial if the torus is split. It's the quadratic character of the splitting field of T otherwise. And I will also let A be explicitly the split torus. A split torus in G. What Jacquet did is he produced a comparison between the relative trace formula for the quotient G mod T mod T and the relative trace formula for the quotient G mod A mod a comma eta, whereby a comma eta is that whenever periods show up, I will also, you know, you can take period against some character of your group. That's also allowed. So what is this relative trace formula? What is? I don't know if you would call it period afterwards. Maybe you would call it period over the diagonal of some subgroup in two products of the group. Okay, you have freedom to play here, but we don't need to go in the utmost generality. So what is this RTF? What is RTF? One thing it's not is a trace, although Jacquet says that there's a notion of relative trace. Basically, it's an inner product. It's an inner product. But it is a generalization of the usual trace formula because the usual trace is also an inner product, except that one of your functions has to be a delta function. Yes? So what is the RTF? In order to explain what is the RTF, I need to introduce two notions. One is some local notion of Schwarz space for G mod T mod T, or for the other case. I'm just going to work on this, and the definitions are analogous. To explain what is this local Schwarz space, this is basically functions you get out of orbital integrals. I will explain it in a lot of detail. And the second thing is, on this, so you will then take some Euler product of these local Schwarz spaces, and the RTF is really some functional, some arithmetic functional on this product. Now you might ask, where is the formula? The formula is really two equivalent ways of expressing this functional. One way is completely geometric, and the other way is spectral and involves these periods of automorphic forms. But I will also use the name RTF just for this functional. So, what is the space? What is the space? So I fix a place V. This is a completion K V of K. And up to some issues with inner forms that I don't want to get into today, this local space G mod T mod T is let me say it vaguely at first. It's the space of functions obtained as T cross T, TV cross TV. Allow me this notation. GV will be G of KV, etc. So they will be TV cross TV orbital integrals of smooth functions of rapid decay on GV. So I start from my space of test functions. Now, most people use compactly supported smooth functions. I prefer to use Schwarz functions, which are almost compactly supported. They are really of rapid decay. Okay, there's a small difference here, but it's not very important. Now, I take a Schwarz function on GV, and I integrate it over orbits of T cross T. And this is what orbital integrals are. But how to parameterize these orbital integrals? These are parameterized by the base. This here? I'll get there. OK. So these orbital integrals are parameterized by the base, which is just the naive way to think of this quotient is just as an affine space using invariant theory. So let's see what are the invariant polynomials, the T cross T invariant polynomials on G. It turns out that these are just the affine line. And to show that, let me show it in the split case. The only invariant that you have, let's say that T is the diagonal torus, and the only invariant that you have acting by the diagonal torus on both sides is the function AD modulo determinant. All invariants are generated freely by this. This means that naively, if you want to think of this quotient, you should think of this quotient as a one-dimensional space with this coordinate. In reality, so you have a map in the group case. The analog would be for GLN, for instance, to start from, when you're talking about conjugacy classes in GLN, you would start from a matrix and take it characteristic polynomial. I'm doing the same kind of invariant theory here. So I have a map from G down to the base. And the fact of the matter is for generic Xi on the base, the preimage is a single T cross T orbit. So indeed, this affine space parameterizes orbits, at least generically. More is true. Outside of Xi not equal to 0 and 1, what is Xi equal to 0 and 1? Xi equals to 0 means that your element is either anti-diagonal or it's upper triangular or lower triangular with respect to this diagonal. And similarly, Xi equal to 1 is upper or lower triangular with respect to this diagonal. Okay, so in these cases, when Xi is 1 or 0, you have several orbits of the torus. You have the diagonals, you have the unipotents, you have several orbits. Okay, outside of these two bad points, this map is a smooth morphism of varieties. And what smoothness means is that, so here I can answer Yaakov's question. These orbital integrals will be thought of as a subspace of functions on the base. Well, functions on B regular. Well, B regular is, by definition, B without 0 and 1. So the points that generically parameterize orbits, I take orbital integrals, I start from a function upstairs, I end up with a function downstairs. A better way to think about it is measures. Start from a smooth measure here and push it forward. Smooth measure means a measure which is a smooth function, locally at least, times an invariant measure, a Haar measure. Okay, if you push it forward, you get some measure here. This measure will be smooth on the smooth locus of this map. But in general, it will have singularities. So what will these push forwards look like? Well, let me draw their graph. We have these two bad points, 0 and 1. Okay, so away from these bad points, I just explained that these measures will be, or these functions will be smooth, because you're pushing forward measures through a smooth map. Moreover, close to infinity, they will be of rapid decay, because my test functions were of rapid decay. And then close to the singularities, you will have some ugly behavior. Not so ugly, it turns out. The behavior turns out to be the same both around 0 and around 1. So let me describe what it is around 0. Maybe I'll do it on a new board. So around x equals 0, an element of this Schwarz space of the quotient is of the following form. If the local character is trivial, it's of the form d1 xi plus d2 of xi ln absolute value of xi. Otherwise, it's c1 of xi plus c2 of xi times eta v of xi. This is something that you just compute. So you see that these functions are not smooth at 0. These c1, ci, di are c infinity. OK, but the logarithm and this character are not smooth functions at 0. This is just some computation that one has to do. Is that clear at this point?
Where is this? Where? What kind of computation?
So you have to take a function, a test function f, in Schwarz functions on your group. Okay, and then integrate it over t cross t orbits. So f of xi. Let me not explain it in this language, though, because it's not going to be useful for what I'm going to do afterwards. And the kernel also is, at this point, I'm talking about the local calculation, right? So the kernel comes in to the global calculation. I'll get there. Xi is some parameter here on the regular set. So it's parametrizing
over some local field or
up to here, I'm over a local field. Yes? So I'm taking a measure upstairs.
But the second expression looks smooth, right? It's just a
no, because I have this multiplicative character. Close to 0, the multiplicative character is not smooth. Yes? And actually, the two expressions, if you think about them, they are the same. You have close to 0, you have generalized eigenfunctions for the multiplicative group, and their characters are 1 and eta v. So if eta is trivial, a generalized eigenfunction for the multiplicative group becomes a logarithm. So it's the same expression. So just to finish answering this question, the definition, starting from this test function, I get a function downstairs, which is just the integral of f of t, some lift of xi, t1, t2, dt1, dt2. OK. But really, it's better. It's really more canonical to think of a measure and to just say, you know, I'm pushing forward a measure. So I still haven't told you globally what this is, but let me just say what the local result of Jacquet is. So you do the same definitions with the non-split torus, except that on one variable, you also put a character, okay, exactly the same definitions. So you get the space SV of G mod T mod T, and you get the space of orbital integrals for this other formula. And Jacquet computed these local integrals. He did this calculation that I mentioned here, that he proved that these spaces are really equal as functions on B, as spaces of functions on B-reg. There's actually, this is the matching, so to speak. There's also a fundamental lemma that says that this equality respects some action of the unramified Hecke algebra. I don't want to get into that. But the point is that you started with two different models. to different geometric situations, and you found out that somehow the space of functions on them are the same. This is the local statement. It's a quadratic character, the local, it's in a Idel class character, yes? And this group is the multiplicative group. All right. So Jacquet proved this matching, that these spaces are equal. I would like to make a remark that in usual comparisons, okay, so this one is a simple example, but usually, for example, in the usual trace formula, these spaces are not exactly equal, but there is a scalar transfer factor. Transfer factor delta of xi, so really a function of your variable that takes one space to the other. The singularities are not exactly the same. Let's call it delta v that you have to multiply with. But this transfer factor is globally vanishing on rational points. So if you take globally rational points and you take the product of those, you will get one. I'm not going to write it up because I don't need it, just to let you know. So we discussed the local spaces and what is the global functional. So RTF. So now let me introduce a global space for G mod T mod T. This will just be some restricted tensor product of the local spaces. This can be thought of as a space of functions on the adelic points of the regular set. But I have to warn you about something, that when you remove a point from the affine line, right, so you have the additive group and you have the multiplicative group, locally they only differ by a point. Globally, adelic points of this are of measure zero in adelic points of that. So really, my functions are defined in a meager set of the adels. Yes? To whom? So I'll show you a Poisson summation formula for these guys. In a moment, I'll show you Poisson summation for these guys. Yes. No, because as measures it makes sense, but it's not absolutely continuous with respect to Hare measure on the adels. And then you cannot evaluate. So what I will define now is that the RTF of G mod T mod T, I said it's a functional on this space. So take a function here. And this is essentially summation over rational points. Up to how to interpret f of 0 and f of 1. Let me not get into this. But essentially, this is summation of rational points. So
k is b of k.
K is b of k, yes.
Presumably, it's supposed to be a fancy way to talk about an orbital integral.
This is what, if you start with kernels and you integrate them over the two tori. These are orbital integrals over rational orbits, yes. These are orbital integrals, global orbital integrals over rational orbits. Once you have the local result, the global result is obvious that, you have an isomorphism locally of these spaces because these are exactly the same. These are exactly the same spaces of functions. No difference here. I suppose I shouldn't write that law. Can you see?
This is the lower.
Okay. So, and on both of these spaces you have an RTF functional, and these functionals match. It's obvious because all you do in both cases, you sum the same functions on the over the same set of points. What does this give spectrally? So on the spectral side, you can interpret RTF G mod T mod T. This is a distribution on G. You can interpret this as an integral over all automorphic representations of certain distributions depending only on the representations. I'll talk about them in a moment. And similarly, RTF G mod A eta is an integral of certain distributions, which I will denote by I sub P. And what are these distributions? Well, recall the period. The period over the subgroup T, which was a T invariant functional on the space of my automorphic representation. By Frobenius reciprocity, you can also think of this as a map into functions on G mod T. And really what this thing contains is something about the absolute value square of this period. So PT of applied to some automorphic form times the conjugate of it can be thought of as a map from pi tensor pi bar to C infinity G mod T cross G mod T. So I'm going to go over very quickly over a bunch of tautological reformulations. So it may not be very easy to check immediately, but all things are tautological here. So when I'm describing these guys, I'm really describing these guys, because by dualizing, I get something like this. And if this representation is unitary, automorphic unitary representation, I have an inner product here. So I end up with a functional on this space, which is invariant under the diagonal copy of the group. And it turns out that, invariant functionals on this quotient, G diagonal co-invariants on this quotient, are nothing but the space that I have defined over there. G is PGL2. G happens to be PGL2 on both sides. I do, but I've hidden them. I don't have time to get into them. The whole thing includes the division algebras. It's hidden in the following thing. If you consider the map from G to the base, you take a point on the base, its pre-image is not a T cross T orbit, it's a T cross T torsor. It may not have points over your field. In order to give it points, you have to consider inner forms of G as well. You have to twist G by torsors. Okay, that's why the relative trace formula is so relevant, because this geometry explains the appearance of inner forms. But I'm hiding them because there's no time to get into that. But all I wanted to say is that describing this square of the period is the same as describing a functional on this space. And this functional is what I call J sub P. This is the guy that shows up here. This may be confusing, but they're tautological reformulations. And similarly, you get the same functional for the split torus, but on one copy here for the split torus, you would want to have the period with the character. So anyway, what is the conclusion of this comparison? The conclusion of this comparison is that for matching functions, we said that these spaces are the same, but let's think of them as being different. We just identify their elements. We have j pi, this is the period with the non-split torus, and this is the period with the split torus. There is some strong analysis, not very strong, but you have an equality between those two, okay? So what you want is you want to separate representation by representation. So I should have said that via the action of the Hecke algebra, so you use the fundamental lemma here in order to separate representation by representation. Okay, a priori you have an integral, an average of periods equal to another average of periods. How do you separate representations? You say the following, basically, that I can let my Hecke algebra, my spherical Hecke algebra, act. Okay, and then on my test functions. Let me explain this later. The point is that you need some representation theoretic information to separate representations. And in what I'm going to talk about, this is completely non-trivial, actually. Here,
is it not related to multiplicity 1 that you can separate the eigenvalues?
Yes, otherwise you would get packets on one side and packets on the other side, yes. All right. So, but what's the conclusion? The conclusion is that something involving T periods is equal to something involving A periods. A is the split torus, and we know from the work of Hecke that this thing can be written as an Euler product over all places of local periods. I can dualize again and tell you what these things are globally, locally. But so So maybe I don't have too much time to explain what are these local periods, but I can only say that for unramified data, for normalized unramified data, whatever this means, it means something that will show up at almost every place. This local period evaluated at some distinguished element here will give you a very interesting L function. This is the base change L function divided by L pi v adjoint 1. More or less, up to factors that don't depend on the representation. Of course, then you can ask me, well, how can you write an Euler product of these things? You're right, this Euler product does not converge, so I have to interpret it using L functions, partial L functions. So all but finitely many factors will be interpreted as the corresponding partial L function. But out of this comparison, Jacquet was able to prove, so in some sense, Jacquet proved factoriality between those two relative trace formulas, and that gave him period relations. This is the period relation. And this period relation tells you that the square of the Valsprouzet period is equal to some Euler product whose local factors, at least almost everywhere, are this.
Okay.
Because I'm taking products here. The JP is dualizing, this is dualizing the product. You have a square on both sides. So here you have, on this side, you have a square, but one period is the split torus, and the other is the split torus with a character, which means that one gives you this, and the other gives you this. OK? All right.
Where does the point of half come from?
The point of half comes from the fact that you don't put a character on the split torus. You cannot,
usually when you're improving this in Boltzmann-Jay's way, you use very heavily the special value of the Ziegel-Bay representation.
Yes.
Special point. From this point of view, the way you're describing it, I don't see where half is important. Why can't you have an identity for every S?
But where will be the S on the other side? Here you can put an S.
It's just,
where was
it? I mean, there it was very clear where the special value came up.
Yeah, here the special value comes up as a specialization of what you would get if you put an S. But there is no S on this side.
You have to match them.
You match them only at the center. But this one from Heike is a continuation of what you get for arbitrary S. All right, maybe let's discuss it in own, because I still haven't gotten to what what's the main goal of this talk, which is okay, one would like to have, so this case of PGL2 mod de torus is just the simplest case of Gross-Prasad. No, this is the old proof of Jacquet. It came a year after Valcrozet. This is the proof of Jacquet. Okay. So this is the simplest case of Gross-Prasad, and one would like to do this more generally, okay, for higher orthogonal groups, SON, cross SON, plus 1, mod SON. That's a general case one would like to do, and there's actually more general conjectures now in my work with Venkatesh. So one would like to have a method to prove relative functoriality for more general class of spaces. What is the problem? The problem is that we relied here on a coincidence. The coincidence was that there was another space whose periods we already knew, and we were able to compare. This you cannot do in general. You cannot do in higher rank. So I want to find a new proof, ignoring the case of G mod A mod eta, which shows up by coincidence, and you cannot generalize it. Whether you can generalize my proof, I'm not so sure. But yes.
In Jacquet's work, he developed the relative trace formula. What's the generality in which he talks, dreams about having a relative trace formula?
Well. Relative trace formula, I mean, you have to ask Jacquet for that, but in my mind, relative trace... No, it's more general than symmetric space. Relative trace formula is you have two spherical G varieties, and you take the quotient by the diagonal G action. And in the special case where X1 is X2 is a group, and G is two copies of the group, you get the trace formula of Arthur.
But he also, does he use symmetric spaces?
Yeah. No, spherical includes symmetric.
I know, right. So what I'm saying is, that's a symmetric space.
It's not.
What's missing is so an extra factor.
This is not symmetric. It's not symmetric. It's really a case of spherical, which is not symmetric, but okay. All right, so if you remember from the beginning of the talk, I said that I want to compare any two RTFs which have the same dual group. So let me give you two RTFs which have the same dual group. One is this, and the other is, and the question is whether we compare them, G is still PGL2. And the other is the Kuznetsov trace formula, in other words, the relative trace formula for G mod unipotent group with a character and unipotent group with a character. This is the Kuznetsov trace formula. So what is the dual group here? Who describes the spectrum of this? The dual group is just SL2, the dual group of G. And here the dual group is again SL2. I'm talking about the dual group of the homogeneous space. So we're in good shape, it seems. We have the same dual groups. But we're actually not in such a good shape, because if you were to prove period relations, the periods that will show up for this trace formula are L pi 1/2, as we just saw. A posteriori, at least, you know that these are the periods. In fact, there are conjectures describing precisely what the periods are in every case. And here, you only get the denominator from the Kuznetsov formula. This and this. This is the comparison between Whittaker and Fourier transforms, and Peterson in a product. So on the spectral side, for every presentation, you get a sum over an orthonormal basis of some periods. Yeah, but for Hecke's work, he unfolds to Whittaker, so you get these factors entering here. That's why you have this factor here. So it seems that we cannot compare these two formulas. By the way, this I will denote by KTF, which is the Kuznetsov trace formula. It's not trace, okay. So in order to be able to compare them, we need to insert L functions, the appropriate L functions, to the Kuznetsov formula. So let me digress a little bit. So beyond endoscopy program of Langlands, of course, a very ambitious program. But as a partial step, it includes being able to insert L functions into your trace formulas and then being able to analytically continue the expression that you get beyond the domain, the obvious domain of convergence. This was done in Venkatesh's thesis. It's been done by many people in other cases. So and how do you insert L functions into the trace formula? Well, if you remember the Kuznetsov-Peterson formula, it just is some explicit expression, depending on two numbers, m and n, of the product of mth and nth Fourier coefficients of representations of cusp forms of a certain weight. I'm not going to give many details. So if you express your favorite L function as a Dirichlet series, in the coefficients, in the Fourier coefficients, let's say I'm talking about automorphic L functions here. Say you can express it as a sum C M N S A M Pi A N Pi bar. And if you can do it, then you can use the Kuznetsov-Peterson trace formula to study this L function, so you can form the corresponding sum C, M, N, S of the Kuznetsov-Peterson trace formulas. Now, adelically, the way this is interpreted, you can think of the input for the Kuznetsov trace formula as follows. Well, before I said that you will take a test function on G and you will integrate it on both sides against some subgroups, but in fact you can already start with a Whittaker function. So you can start with a Whittaker function on this quotient and then integrate against the unipotent on the other side. So this is your input for the KTF. So in particular, M and N will correspond to a particular test function. So what you are really doing is you are forming the sum of these functions. But by doing that, you have lost compact support. So the adelic way to understand these countable sums is that to say that I'm using test functions with non-compact support. So let's call this function Phs. So Phs is some test function of non-compact support on the Whittaker space. That depends on the L function that we want to represent. So you apply the Kuznetsov trace formula to this, and for large S, it converges. Can you say something about what happens for smaller S? Digression number two, I said that I want to compare the RTF for G mod T mod T with the Kuznetsov formula G mod N mod N. A similar comparison has been done in Rudnick's thesis which predates beyond endoscopy by a long time. So he compared the Kuznetsov trace formula for GL2 with the usual trace formula for GL2. So it's not completely clear to me what's the relation between the methods of the two, but there must be a relation. Of course, I go a little bit further in this example because I separate representations and so on and so forth. All right. So since I'm running out of time, let me say what is the result. So on one hand, you will have the usual RTF for G mod T mod T. This is some functional on the space that I introduced before, so I don't need to explain it again. Remember that locally, elements of this space, we had this picture for them. Now, on the other hand, we have the Kuznetsov formula, but this Kuznetsov formula will be applied to test functions like this. And the L function that we're interested in is the L function that I wrote before, the base change L function. Okay? So it will be a Kuznetsov trace formula with a parameter S. It will be applied to the orbital integrals of those guys. What do the orbital integrals of those guys? My notation here is, let me say it again, I'm taking non-standard test functions that are tailored in order to give me the L function that I want at so S corresponds to L pi 1/2 plus S L pi tensor eta 1/2 plus S. So eventually modulo in the beginning I will be in the region of convergence, and of course in the end I want to go to S equals 0. So how do orbital integrals for these guys look like? They have nothing to do with this here. So they have some kind of similar singularity here, but they also have Clostermann sums. They are completely different. They're not even compactly supported. So what is the way to compare them? Well, there is a local matching and a global matching. Local theorem is the following. Consider the following I call it transfer operator. It's the analog of transfer factor on functions on the regular points, whatever regular means here. Functions in one-dimensional line. Okay, so what is this operator? Well, it will be a composition of some things. I'm multiplying by the absolute value. Fourier transform. Something else. It's a crazy operator. So F is Fourier in one variable. And iota is basically inverting the argument. It's a crazy operator, and where it came from is not so clear. I mean, I can tell you how I computed it, But it's not so clear how things like that will generalize. And the statement is that this operator takes one space of test functions, well, orbital integrals, to another space of orbital integrals. So this operator, this gives rise to an isomorphism from the local space of orbital integrals for one of the formulas to the local space for the other with parameter zero. Once you have this operator, you can say, okay, now I can compare the two trace formulas. But what are the true trace formulas? Here I said that the relative trace formula is summation over rational points. In principle, I would like to do the same here. But if this thing converged, then that would mean that the L function at the half would converge, the Euler product. Okay? So this thing doesn't make sense for S equals 0. Okay? So you need to prove a second local theorem, which is the same as the first one, but you compare the space with parameter S now, not zero, with a deformation of the other guy. I don't have time to explain what kind of deformation. But the important element is that you have some integral transform given by Fourier transforms and things like that that takes these horrible orbital integrals into something that's essentially compactly supported. The deformation remains essentially compactly supported, like these test functions here. So this allows you to analytically continue this to S equals 0. So the corollary is that this KTFS can be analytically continued to S equals 0. And now you would like to have some kind of equality between the two. But equality between the two means to prove some Poisson summation formula for this transform applied to this space of functions that I had written before. And since these functions are not defined but only on a meager set of the adels, you understand that there is a big problem in doing that, although this transform is given by Fourier transforms and explicit things. But so I was hoping that I would actually have a lot of time to talk about this today. I don't know why I thought about this. But the theorem is some Poisson summation formula for this transform. Namely, it says that if you take a test function for the torus and you form the corresponding sum over rational points, this is the same as taking Kuznetsov trace formula at zero in the sense of analytic continuation of the transform of this function. This is a Poisson summation formula for this transform. Once you have that, then translating to the spectral side, so the corollary is that translating to the spectral side, the integral over all automorphic representations of these periods that I showed to you before is the same as the analytic continuation. So let me write it as a limit. I really mean analytic continuation of the corresponding integral for Whittaker periods. So how to denote them? Maybe R sub pi. These are similar distributions using Whittaker periods and applied to test functions with parameter s. If you can isolate representations, and this would be the next theorem, but I think I'm way over time, so the next theorem is that actually each individual guy here, let me put an S, each individual guy has analytic continuation to all S. That means analytic continuation for the base change L function to all S, purely by trace formula means. So analytic continuation of R I S to all S, and the equality that j pi is equal to the analytic continuation of this at zero. This here means the analytic continuation of the base change L function. This here means essentially the formula of Alfrouzé, that torus periods can be identified with Whittaker periods for a transfer. There's still some work to do, but you can do it. But basically some Euler product that includes the base change L function. So I apologize because I was hoping that I would go spend more time on this, but okay, I didn't plan very well.
I guess you want to wrap, right?
Okay, so I think let's end the lecture, but I think anybody who wants to quiz him and go a little bit later to the other seminar, stay behind. Let's thank your speaker. Okay, you can't go.